Hey guys, how's it going? Whoa, that's loud. Whoa, Jesus, back off. Thanks for coming. You guys having a good Comic-Con so far? So far, so good. I mean, it's early in the day, nothing's gone wrong yet. Thanks for coming. My name is Dalton Ross. I'm at Entertainment Weekly Magazine and Entertainment Weekly Radio. Very excited to be here today to talk about the Squicker Wonkers. Like most of you in this room, I'm guessing, I first met Evangeline Lilly when her plane, Oceanic 815, crashed onto a mysterious island. She seemed nice enough. She had some weird handcuff marks around her wrists, but, you know, I was willing to overlook that. Well, she finally got off the island. Then she went back to the island. And she got off the island again. There was sort of sideways stories and parallel universes. It was all very confusing. But then we started meeting her in other things, right? We met her in Real Steel. We met her in The Hobbit. We met her in Ant-Man. Pretty soon we're going to be meeting her as the Wasp. Let me say, I am very excited to meet her as the Wasp. But along the way, I also met the real Evangeline in, like, real life. And I learned something I didn't know about her. Not only is she this tremendous actress that stars in all these great geek-tastic franchises, but she's also, like me, a writer. And like me, she has a bit of a dark and twisted side. And she's been pouring that side of her into this super cool world she created called the Squicker Wonkers. And you guys have been looking at some great slides of it up here, which she put together for you, by the way. It's really awesome. All right, so the Squicker Wonkers is her true passion project, a book series she first dreamt up as a teenager, if you can believe that. She put out her first book a few years ago and then met a man who shared her delightfully dark and twisted vision, illustrator Rodrigo Bastos Didier. They are now working on the second book, The Demise of Selma the Spoiled, and to tide people over, they have a New York Comic-Con exclusive, only available here, called The Squicker Wonkers, an Artist's Sketchbook. It's awesome. And now to tell us all about it, without further ado, Evangeline Lilly and Rodrigo Bastos Didier. They're coming in right over there. Give them a hand, everyone. Guys, all right.
I can't see.
Here we go.
Here.
I know, right? Flashlights right in the eyes.
I'm going to interrupt you already.
Do
before
it.
You do anything,
let's do this.
This is Rodrigo Bastos Didier. I want to introduce him to the world.
Thank you for having me.
Not only his first Comic-Con, but his first time in New York City, right here, ever.
Big Apple.
Well, we should be specific. His first New York Comic-Con.
Yeah. Oh, right. New York Comic-Con. That's right. All right. So listen, let's give a little background here. Because I mentioned, Evangeline, that you first came out this up with the story when you were a teenager. But how did you first come up with the story? What was the germ of the idea here for you? And as we talk about this, I'm going to put up the slide of the first book. How did you come up with this whole world?
Well, not unlike a lot of people in this crowd, I was a loner in school. And I didn't really love high school, and I didn't really love hanging out with teenagers. And so I spent a lot of time alone. And at the time, I was also a really late bloomer when it came to books. I was really digging Dr. Seuss. I was like 14. I mean, a really late bloomer. And I was so jealous that he felt that he could just make up any word he wanted to make a rhyme. Like, there was this sort of confident audacity about that. Like, if I don't have a rhyming word, I'll make one up. And I thought, I want to make up my own words. And so I started making this list of weird Zeus-esque, Zeus-inspired words. And there was one that just was delicious. It just felt so good on my tongue. And I just loved it, which was this word, Squicker Wonkers. And so I was inspired to write a poem called The Squicker Wonkers. And I did. And my mother just gushed and said, oh, you should publish that. And I thought, well, moms like everything we do, right? I'm not going to take my mom's word for it that I should publish my poem. And never really thought about it. But every couple years, my mom would check in. What are you doing with that Squicker Wonker poem? What are you doing with that? And so I kept it and kept it and kept it. Cut to 23 years later, and I now have a published book called The Squicker Wonkers.
It's right? Dreams come true. Now, I noticed in your first book, Peter Jackson helped write the foreword, and I couldn't help but wondering whether how you got him to do that and whether that was written into your Hobbit contract. Like, I will appear in your movie, but you're going to have to do this for me.
For those of you who don't know, Peter Jackson is a director. He made a little trilogy called Lord of the Rings. I was inspired to actually create the book because of working with Peter and being around his creative team and his, I mean, he's such an inspired, crazy, mad magician. You know, he just is making things in his pot all day. And I was like, I want to make things in my pot. So I engaged what a workshop to find an illustrator and started working on it. And so I was actually making the book while I was filming The Hobbit. And so his beautiful wife, Fran Walsh, became a dear mentor of mine during that time. And Philippa Boyens, those two women would sit down with me and help me work on my book and give me editing notes. And, you know, we would work on it together. And so, of course, there would be dinners where Peter would be around and I would show him the manuscript or I would show him the illustrations and what we were working up. And so it kind of became this thing that they were fostering with me, and they really believed in me, and I was just very, very lucky to be in the right place at the right time with the right people.
Did he like his Squicker Wonker? Him? His drawing?
Yes. Oh, yeah, his. Did you guys own it? For those of you who haven't seen the first book, there is a Peter Jackson Squicker Wonker in here. So Squicker Wonkers are marionette puppets, and there is, at the beginning, with the forward, there's a Squicker Wonker Peter Jackson, a Squicker Wonker Fran Walsh, and a Squicker Wonker Philippa Boyens. There's also a Squicker Wonker Evangeline Lilly, of course.
That's right, of course, Mac. I want to get into, in a minute, we're going to talk about how you guys hooked up and started meeting and talking about this. But what I've talked with you a little bit about this before, Evangeline, but I find it very interesting because this world that you've created, and I say this as a compliment, is a little deranged. but I find
actually,
that
that word is used in the second book. I actually use the word deranged in number two, which is coming out September 2017. Mark it in your calendars.
And it's you know, more than the average children's book. And I've always felt that children are a lot more sophisticated than we give them credit for. And they can really understand and handle things in a different way than maybe we think. Was that ever a struggle for you in terms of getting publishers and people on board to understand that? Or were they like, whoa, this is a little too out there?
They still are like, whoa. Titan Books was pretty much the only publisher brave enough to tackle this book, and it's because it doesn't fit into any molds that are, you know, currently existing for kids. And there was a lot of pushback about this is very dark and it's very sophisticated. And I remember being a kid and being bored to tears with the bubblegum and unicorn and, you know, Care Bear books that were offered to me, and I just had zero interest in books. And then I stumbled upon an author called Edward Gorey. And I was like, oh, books, what are these magical, amazing things? And he spoke to me on my level, and his humor was so sophisticated. For him to take that chance that it could be hilarious to do an ABC book about the gruesome death of 26 children was incredible, that he trusted the kids would get that this is both terrifying and hilarious at the same time, and I did. And so I know there are other kids out there who are desperate for some meat to get their teeth into when they are looking for books, and they don't just want to learn about, you know, princesses. And so that is the Squicker Wonkers.
That's great. Yeah. I love it. All right. Now, I mentioned that I want to talk about how you guys met up and started working together. I know sort of the outline of the story, but not all the details. It's a pretty great one. Rodrigo, how did you end up working with Evangeline Lilly? How did this happen? How did you even get a hold of her? How did this all meet up go down?
Oh, this is a crazy story, first time. Because the true story is that she left her laptop fall on the ground and then finally typed my email on it, I don't know, and sent to me. I saw, oh my God, Evangeline Lilly in my email. I'll send her my work and my work of art and see what she likes or what she think about it. So she just replied to me, said, man, come illustrate my next book. So I said, okay, great.
End of story. That was what happened. My laptop fell on the ground. He picked it up.
That's pure luck.
This is history.
Yeah.
No, don't go on. No.
There
is an equally as ridiculous and impossible story behind this.
And this is almost an advice for all the artists that are out there, or people that want to push forward and go ahead and keep moving with their work. So I was there in my house. So I first met the Squeaker Wonkers when I made a donation for the Prizeo campaign. So I got the audiobook and the ebook too. So I got to read it and I love it. And I saw all the illustrations and I thought about it. So what it should look if I had illustrated this book. So I did the first image, the first painting of my version of this, the Selma the Spoiled and the bear and almost the entrance of the wagon.
I'm going to put it up right now. So what we're going to see is this is an actual image. He just was inspired, drew one, sent it to Evangeline Lilly. You can see it right there. And what, you sent it to her on Facebook or something?
Yeah, so you can actually go on Facebook today and see this exactly thread.
I made this painting for you after reading the digital copy. This book is awesome and very inspiring. I hope you enjoy. Cut to reply from Evangeline Lilly. I am so enamored by this incredible rendering. I am speechless. It's gorgeous. Thank you so much for sharing. May I have your permission to share this with my fans? And look at the date on that. That was in 2014. That was 3 years ago.
I was dead in the ground that time.
So what happened? You send her this image. You love the image. And then where did it go from there?
So everything started coming together because I was working with the guys at the Comic-Con in Brazil, the Comic-Con experience. So I talked to them. So what do you think about invite Evangeline to come to Comic-Con in Brazil? So they start talking about this, and I start doing other works to show to her on that because I really wanted to be an illustrator for the second book. So that happens, and we first met in December of 2015. So at a Comic-Con. So that at the whole time I was
this
like...
This guy just like took a chance. Like he showed up with a portfolio full of art, and I was going to meet him because I knew he had been part of inviting me, and he sat down with me and was like, I just want to show you my art. And I was like, oh, this guy's hungry. He was so nonchalant about it, but I was like, he's got ambition.
And not only that, but you made him work for the gig though, right? Like it wasn't, no drawing was gonna do. Like she put you through the ringer a little bit,
well,
right?
Well, the art, I mean, so this art is just breathtaking, but I was like, that's not the right style for this book. It's just, I would love to do a Squeaker Wonker version in that style, but that's not this one. So we started working together on adjusting the style and making it fit the book and making it fit the first book. And there was a constant back and forth for 6 bloody months working to try to build up to a sample that he would send me that would match the style. And after 6 months, he sent me a sample. And I said, sorry, you don't have the gig. It's not right. And I thought... And I thought he would hate me forever. He would be like on Facebook, she's a horrible person.
6 months down the tubes.
6 months of no pay, work for nothing. And then he just actually looked me in the eye and said, listen, when I was born, I didn't know how to paint. I didn't know how to draw. I can learn anything. Just give me another chance. And I was like, wow, this guy believes in himself and is so passionate about this project. So I did. And we spent another 2 months working on it. He sent in another sample, and it was so close. And I was like, oh, he's gonna get it. He's got it, he's got it. And so we engaged.
It's great. And so you guys, you're gonna have the, next year, as you mentioned, we're gonna have the new book. But in the meantime, you guys came up with this artist sketchbook, which you can see right here. You can only get it here. In fact, we're gonna put it up on the big screen for you as well. You can only get it here. It's a New York Comic Con exclusive, and it's an artist's sketchbook. Tell us why you all decided to do this, to sort of, you know, peel back the curtain a little bit and show the process is made.
Well, all of you love behind-the-scenes DVD extras, right? And I always, I mean, I don't really watch those so much, but I always want to know, like, how did this get made? And I love sketches, and I love the skeleton of finished art. I just love seeing, like, the old Disney animations when they're just the black and white sketch, or they're just the little watercolor painting. That's really fascinating and beautiful to me. So not only did we want to invite you guys into the process that we went through during those 8 months of trying to design the second book and find the characters and find the style, but also there's, you know, like a shift in the look. So this book was illustrated by a different person, a different artist, and I wanted Rodrigo to be able to put his stamp on it. So we wanted to give you a little taste of what the look's going to be for the next book. And then also,
what am I going to say?
Well, what I find interesting about it is that you have to, how did you guys come up with, and Rodrigo, I can ask you this first, how did you come up with keeping the original spirit of this world while tweaking and modifying things? You couldn't be too jarring, as Evangeline said when you sent your first image. Couldn't be too jarring, but you wanted to have that DNA and fabric of the world, but a little bit different, right?
Yeah, at first you can think that doing, like, having this first book, beautifully illustrated by Johnny Fraser Allen, and then had to do the second book, but with something that looks like, that resembles the first look. You can ask me, oh, but it's kind of, I don't know, it feels right to do it this, because it's almost, you can feel that it's the same characters, so there is another artist that created it. But no, it's kind of everything here, it's new, but resembles something. It's almost like everything we have. So these 8 months of work, of that back and forth, so this is exactly right here. Inside here, you have all the sketches and everything that makes everything work together. So I think it's too important. It's so much important than the book itself. So the process of doing it.
Getting from point A to point B, exactly. Yeah. And point B, and by the way, so we talk about this, let's put up a slide of the next book, what we will see as the final product. The Demise of Selma the Spoiled. There it is. And you see the new look. And what I find interesting about this, Evangeline, is that you created the characters in the first book. But in the new book, you're creating an entire world. They're leaving the wagon. They're going to the world of Rin Run. So how do you approach that? Not just, okay, I've got the characters, but now I have to create a whole space for them.
That was the most exciting new challenge, and just being able to breathe some fresh air into the book. So one of the intentional things in this book that I love is it's claustrophobic, and we did that on purpose. We wanted the reader to feel through the detail of the illustrations that they were actually in the wagon, and there was this oppressive creepiness around them, and it's very heavy. And when the book ends, no spoilers. You know, we don't ever leave the wagon. We're just left inside of the wagon. And so I was very excited to now, there's a sort of plot twist at the end that brings us to a space where the Squicker Wonkers are going to leave the wagon. And so now they're out in the world and they're wandering around. And I wanted to show that the world was very juxtaposed to the Squicker Wonkers. So the Squicker Wonkers are these crazy, eccentric, misfit outcasts who are very colorful and very alive and vices. I mean, they all have vices. There's Andy the Arrogant and Lorna the Lazy and Papa the Proud and Greer the Greedy. They're all kind of nasty, a little bit nasty. And the world of Rin Run is like boring as toast. It's just dull, and people are very straight, and people are very monotone, and yet there is sort of this like we can breathe, and we wanted space, and we wanted light, and we wanted color to be a little bit more vibrant and alive, so that there's that feeling of sunlight and a kind of fresh start.
Well, and then in the sketchbook, Peter Jackson would be very proud, because you have a whole sort of map of Rin Run. It's very Tolkien-esque of you to have like open up, and there's the map. At any point, but I guess
you are talking to two diehard Tolkien fans.
There you go. See,
we were like, "Can we do a Tolkien map? Let's do a Tolkien map."
There's the influence. And now at any point when the Squicker Wonkers leave the wagon and go out into town, will one of them say, "We have to go back"? I had to ask. So, Rodrigo, how did you deal with the contrast that Evangeline's just talking about? How you have the Squicker Wonker characters, but you have the town characters and making them look and feel different while being in the same style? Because as an artist, I'm sure that's a challenge somewhat.
Yeah, that's definitely a challenge because one thing that I want to say before that is that I never did something like this before. So in my previous work, artworks, you never find something like this, you know, in this style. So this style was born for this book and to deliver the message, to deliver the poem to you guys the best way possible. So I always believe that this style can born to a major purpose, you know. So creating the characters was very hard because we have a major change from the first book to the second book. There is the characters are not made of, they are not sack puppets anymore. So they are wood puppets. So this was in a kind of a better choice for me too, because with wood you can have different colors, different grains, and different wood types, and you can have this kind of richness of details of wood carving. And I'm a sculptor too, and I like to carve wood and work with clay, so to paint these figures, like if it was a sculptor made of wood, was great because every character can have his own unique pattern and his own unique design. And now in this second book you can have the chance to meet the ring run field, the people, the culture and everything. So to make this really matches, because the Squicker Wonkers are extremely interesting and the people of Ring Run is exactly the opposite. They are boring, and so you have this funny contrast, and to make this was really, really good. And it's very hard at the same time because it had to feel in the same place. It has to feel in the same story. So I think we did that together, and you all can see in this book.
Yeah, you can see the process in the sketchbook.
We actually, he is an incredible, I mean, there's no form of art that he can't do. It's both wonderful and sickening. and we're going to show you a little special something later, a video that he made specifically for this panel that no one else has seen. And I want to remember when it's over to show you the actual piece. So let's not forget, okay? After the video's over, he's brought a little something to show you guys from the province of Rin Run, one of the characters. And that's all I'll say before I wreck the surprise.
We'll do the video in a minute. And by the way, after that, we will get to your questions. So you can start thinking about that now. But I have to ask each of you, because the Squicker Wonkers, what I love about them is each individual one has a vice, basically, right? I want to know what your vices are. I want to know if you were a Squicker Wonker and there was all going to be about your vice, what would it be? Evangeline, I'll start with you.
I would be Carrie the controlling. He can tell you.
Do I have one for you?
Yeah. I mean, I think I have all those.
You would be...
all those ones, yeah.
Peter the obnoxiously perfect.
All right, fair enough. I'll take it. So we got the second book. We see the title there. But Evangeline, you came up with this 20 years ago. How many stories do you have in your head?
Too many. I'm in the midst of working. So this is supposed to eventually be, if Titan will let me, an 18-book series. And it'll be two series of 9 books. The first will be The Demise of the Squicker Wonkers. The second will be The Origins of the Squicker Wonkers. And that is flipped on its head on purpose for wonderful, mysterious reasons. You'll find out. And then I'm also working with Titan on a graphic novel series called The Fortress. And that originally was a script I wrote about 10 years ago, and we're adapting it. And I have this, I've never said this in public before. I have this TV show up my sleeve, a sci-fi TV show up my sleeve that I would love to make a reality. I've actually finally, for the first time, started taking steps to do that. It's been in my head for so long. And but those are just a few. I have truly, there's so many more. I have too many.
There's too many things going on up there.
I can't shut it up. I don't sleep well because it's just too many. It's like a schizophrenic. All my stories are just yelling at me all the time. Make me.
All right, well, Evangeline teased it. We do have a video for you guys. It's a special video that they made just for you to be seen here. So we're going to check that out now. And then there's a surprise that I don't even know about coming up afterwards. And then we will get to your questions. So start thinking of your questions for these guys. All right, let's go to the video right over there.
Can you guys turn out these lights while the video plays? Thank you.
And there he is! Bathtub man! So cool. So we saw that in 4 minutes. How long did it really take you from start to finish to make that?
10 days.
10 days.
Yeah, just...
Peter the practically perfect.
And the challenging part was to record and do at the same time because I didn't have any help to do the video. So I put the tripod with the camera, so I was looking at the... I put a mirror behind the camera so I can see if it's shooting right, everything. So
that's not my good side. Yeah.
So it was much more difficult than the actual sculpture. It was to record the process to show you guys.
And the worst part was while he was in the middle of doing it, filming himself, sculpting, carving, painting, there was a baby that was about to be run over in the street, and he ran out and he captured the baby up into his arms, and he saved it.
What was the hardest part of making that, besides the filming?
I think for this bathtub, I think to take everything and make the calculating right, to feel that the bottom is narrower than the top part, and actually to hammer the aluminum wire to make it feel... This is because the clay is very fun to work on and to work with it. So, and the eyes are always challenging because the eyes are almost the soul of the sculpture. If they're not right, you can't feel that it's alive, you know?
You put that on your customs form when you came from Brazil, like checking your bathtub, man? Carrying a bathtub, man.
Yeah.
I want to make a note before we get to the Q&A here that Evangeline and Rodrigo are going to be doing signings right here. So you can see all the signings, photo ops with Evangeline and Rodrigo. You can check it out right there today. But lucky you guys for being right here, because now is the time when you can ask them questions about the book or ask Evangeline questions about her movie and TV roles, whatever you want to ask. There is a microphone right over there. And you can line up. You can line up, and we'll take a few of your questions here. Whatever you guys got for us. Thank you so much. And want you to tell us your name, and then you can ask your question. Go right ahead.
Dude, I'm so happy you made it to the mic first.
I know, right?
Ooh. You read the first book. I could tell by the way. Have you read the first book?
I actually haven't. I'm just really excited about it.
I love it. It's like this.
Oh. It's exactly the sort of books I'm interested in, children or adult-wise. So. Yeah, I love your description of what you were interested in and not interested in when you were younger. It's cool. So anyway, I know you from Lost, obviously. I love your work. I want to read your work. So my question is actually related to both of those things. Has your work in television or in other media influenced your content in your books, or vice versa? Because I know some of the way you've described Skwikkerwonkers is that, you know, like sort of like these outcast misfits or people with like these, you know, troubled, you know, they have like quirks that are not so great. You know, it sort of reminded me of the characters on Lost a little bit. So I'm wondering if either influenced the other in any way, et cetera, something like that, yeah.
I think it's a really good question, first of all, because it's been... When I first got into reading as a young adult, I loved the classics.
Oh, me too.
And I thought one day if I started writing, I would want to write very dramatic, very intense, potentially like underlyingly political novels, you know, the kind of books that I was reading. And then I spent 13 years making fantasy and sci-fi stuff for the screen and coming to comic cons. And people started asking me, like, have you always been a sci-fi fantasy geek? And I was like, and then I would stop in my tracks and go, wait a minute, I always loved fantasy, I loved fairies, I loved unicorns, I loved Tolkien, I loved Edward Gorey, who was, you know, really out there for a kid. I loved this book called The Rainbow Goblins that was, you know, then I started to like really look at what I was interested in, what I liked, and also the projects that I seemed to have attracted in my acting career. And I realized that along the way, somewhere, I started to just, like, what was ruminating in my head was being so influenced by what I was doing in my acting career that now everything I write is, like, fantasy or sci-fi. And I actually kind of get worried sometimes because I think, wait, am I only writing in that genre because that's where my fans are and that's what I'm doing, or is it because that's what I love? But I kind of think in life, it carries you and it directs you. And, you know, you can have all the plans in the world, but life knows better. And it knows where you're supposed to be and it knows what you're supposed to be doing. And if you can trust that and just take the leap and just let it, like a wave, like a surfer, just let it take you, you'll find yourself in the right place. So that's what I'm doing and hoping that writing in these genres is going to work out.
Awesome. And everything you do becomes a part of you, right?
Yeah, and it shapes you.
Yeah. Yeah. Awesome. Thanks a lot, Evangeline.
Thank you.
Thanks for your question. Hey, what's your name?
Hi, my name's David. How are you? First off, I want to say, Rodrigo, that is amazing work that you do.
Thank you so much.
I want to commend you on that.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Look at that.
Awesome. Thank you.
So my question is actually for Evangeline. Since in the first book you have an opening by Guillermo del Toro and actually a character based on his likeness, have you and him had discussions about making it a movie? Because being that he's known for making movies with eccentric characters that like mystical and mythical type.
Johnny Fraser Allen, the original illustrator for the first book, had worked with Guillermo before and had a relationship with him and was very, very inspired by him. So there's definitely a Guillermo feeling within the first book. And I've actually never met him myself. And I have had discussions with different people and places, like studios, about like, could this be a film? And it's mine and Rodrigo's dream to one day have him be doing a lot of this and then making them move frame by frame by frame by frame, because we want to see the Squicker Wonkers come to life. We want to see them dancing across the stage. We want to see them running around in Rin Runs. So that's the dream, but I want to make sure that we give the books all of our loving attention first. And I want there to be at least 5 or 6 books out before we even, you know, engage in the idea. That said, I have written an outline for the movie.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Hey, man, what's your name?
My name's Nick. I do have a question for both Rodrigo and Evangeline, but first I want to say, a couple years ago I took a fiction writing class for children's novels, and I hated everyone else's work because it was very cookie cutter, and no one would read my work because I wrote a thing called The Family of Freaks, which is about a family of circus freaks.
You wrote the Squicker Wonkers.
And I heard about this last month from my friend, like, oh, you should see this book. And I read a little bit of it. I was like, wow, this is the kind of children's story I would want to read. So I want to thank you for actually taking, you know, the risk of actually doing something that's not, you know, any part of the mold. But I do have basically the same question for the both of you. What was your favorite part in writing it, and what was your favorite part in drawing it?
How about you go first?
Yeah, Rodrigo.
My favorite part of drawing it is that, as I said, the style that was born with it. So it's almost like the writing has took shape in my drawing. So it's a very organic feel. It's not something that pre-exists already and then writing and you put together. So it feels like it belongs to the same place. And of course, many of my works are digital today. So people ask a lot to digital painting and everything. So the best part of it, and we would not have this sketchbook if this wasn't possible, because Evangeline loves the drawing on paper and the charcoal, so the watercolors and everything. So the best part is that, is because everything's here in my pocket, in my backpack. So all the papers, all the drawings and everything, they are not files and with megabytes. So they're actually pieces of art that in the future we will have an exhibition or something for you guys to see it.
Would you bring some out right now?
Yeah.
And show them?
No.
Yeah.
What isn't in your bag, by the way? You keep taking things out. It's like...
It's a bag of holdings.
It's like Mary Poppins, practically.
It's all in there, man. It's all in there.
Going back to it. For me, my my favorite thing about writing these books is that, and it's the thing I've been advised against the most, I find that always the things you enjoy the most are the things that the people who make money will tell you not to do. I was told over and over, do not do this in rhyme. Don't do it in rhyme. Because not only is it hard to sell, but it's hard to succeed at, and then it's really hard to translate. So you'll have a really hard time if you want to sell it in other countries. But I love rhyme. I love it so, so, so much. And not only writing it, and the surprises that I find in rhyme, like, for example, deranged, that word ends up in the second book. And that was a happy accident, because I was looking for a word that rhymed with, you know, and it wound up being like, oh, deranged. Like, that's the word, and it's perfect. And, you know, it's like, I wouldn't have used that word if it hadn't rhymed. And sometimes that is a limitation, and, you know, you can feel yourself sort of like, oh, I'm trying to stretch the meaning to make something rhyme, and I refuse to settle for that. I always wait for that penny to drop and for it to be like, oh, it just got better because I was trying to rhyme it, and I wouldn't have ever come up with this on my own. And then for children, if you're reading it out loud to them, the sort of music of rhyme and how it flows and how children can be taken away on the, you know, the wings of a story through rhyme. And even if they don't understand every single word because of the rhyme, they feel it, they feel the energy, they feel the essence of what you're telling them. And I did an interactive book for iTunes that I had the illustrious Sylvester McCoy narrate. And so you can go on iTunes and you can buy the iBook for the first book that Sylvester McCoy narrates in the most magical way. And I worked for 2 years with a composer on the soundtrack. And we will be doing that again for the second book and for the third and the fourth. I always intend to do the audiobook. I think the second one, I'll narrate it. Because it's got a more feminine energy. The first book has a more masculine energy. But hearing him say the rhymes out loud and doing the voices, it just brings it to life.
Rodrigo, share some of these works you have here.
Yeah, there are some here that the Squeaker Wonkers logo with gold leaves. So
he actually put gold leaf, like that's real gold leaf.
Yeah, so it's some watercolors on it.
Oh, I love this creepy Selma. I don't know if you guys can see it, but yeah,
this is
pretty amazing.
The one that is in back.
Yeah.
Okay.
And look at this. I love that stuff. I love the mess of an artist's world.
This was the first page that I drew on paper when I first heard, when I first read a book. So
that's also in the book here, in the inside cover. Yeah.
And the most part of in this red, nice.
And here's the bathtub man.
Bathtub man. All the originals.
Look at this one, this page. Look at Sparky. Sparky the spectacle.
Oh, she's
awesome.
Here. Okay.
Thank you for your question.
Yeah, thanks for the question.
Hi, Brianna.
Hi.
This is one of my super elves.
So I was wondering, now that you've worked with different artists, like how different it is, you know, each time.
Wow. Wow. I mean, it's just so incredibly different. In my experience, art is born of the person. It's born of their soul. And you actually can see a person's soul on paper. And even when they're trying to adapt to make something work for carry the controlling's needs and wishes, you still can never take an artist away from themselves. And that was the greatest challenge and the greatest joy of collaborating with both Johnny and Rodrigo, was first of all discovering them through their art and getting to know them a little better through their art, but also the challenge of finding that blend of them and me. And Rodrigo is so passionate about the story, the narrative, the characters, and making sure that they're honored and that they come through in the vision that I had for them. And, you know, in the same way, I'm so passionate about making sure that you all meet him through his art and get to know him, because he's such an incredible, generous, kind-hearted, soft-spoken, lovely human being.
Yeah, thank you.
Aww. Right?
Hug it up.
Oh, there they go. How cute is that? Amazing. Hey, man, how's it going? What's your name?
Hi, my name's James. I flew in from South Korea a couple of days ago. I would like to tell Evangeline that we have a lot of Lost fans, we have a lot of Taoreo fans, we have a lot of Hope Van Dyne fans. So we all love you back there. And I'm sure once we get through the difficult task of translating rhymes, I'm very positive from what I've seen today that Rodrigo, your following will also increase. So this looks great. I do have a question for you, Evangeline. So with all this work and your screenwriting stuff in the works, I don't know, maybe 5 years, 10 years down the line, in the future, do you see yourself leaning towards writing or more acting, or is there like a particular place you'd like to be concerning these two?
If you had asked me that 5 years ago, I would have said my dream is to be able to have my pen fill up my days and put down my acting career. Sorry. I heard this like,
dare you.
Over there. but since then, I have worked on The Hobbit and on Ant-Man, and truly just had so much fun. I felt like I was really playing house. I'm currently working on a movie called Little Evil, where I play the mother of the Antichrist. As you can imagine, it's a comedy. Actually, it is a comedy. It's a horror comedy, which I've never tried before. I almost got a chance to work with Edgar Wright on Ant-Man, who of course does amazing horror comedy. And as someone who loves Edward Gorey, I clearly love horror comedy. And I'm just having fun with it. I don't know, I'm in a really tough place because I'm having too much fun with my acting career at the moment, a lot of my writing gets put on the back burner. Previously, my writing for a couple years now, for about 5 years now, it was the thing I spent all my time on, and so you haven't seen me on screen much. And I don't know where those chips are gonna fall. I mean, the truth is, the reality is, there is a shelf life for an actor. You know, there just aren't that many jobs for an older actor. And so I keep reminding myself, like, play now, because there might come a time where you don't have a choice and there is more time, and then you can devote yourself to your writing.
Great.
Thank you.
Evangeline Lilly for Oscar screenwriter one day.
They don't give Oscars to sci-fis. What's with that?
I know. Hey, how's it going? What's your name?
Hi, my name is Spencer. I have a question for Evangeline. Now that you're a member of the Tolkien universe family and a big fan of Tolkien's works, is there a scene or a quote or a moment from either the Hobbit movies or the Tolkien books that really means a lot to you?
And that's an interesting question because your character wasn't in the books.
Yeah.
So that's, you know, you could go, you know.
Well, the two, like what you just said and what she just asked about kind of meld together a little bit, because when I was a little girl, The Hobbit was for a time my favorite book, and my absolute favorite moment in the book that just has stuck with me for my whole life is when the dwarves are in Mirkwood and they're being lured off the path by the Mirkwood elves, and they're being lured essentially by their drunken orgies. I mean, it's not said so explicitly, but it's implied. Tolkien was very PC, but we all know what was going on with those elves. And, you know, there was those flickering lights in the woods, and there was the sound of their music and their partying, their laughter and their joy. And I had this, like, to me, at that moment, I was like, I want to be a Mirkwood elf. I got to be a Mirkwood elf. And yeah, I mean, talk about childhood dreams come true. I actually got to play in Mirkwood as an elf. I got to go down into their wine cellars, and you know, I mean, it's ridiculous. And then, of course, they told me I was going to be a Mirkwood elf, and I was like, I'm going to get to bewitch the dwarves off the path. Took it out of the movie. I mean, it wasn't ever in there. It was not in the script. It was like, well, that was my moment, and I didn't get to have my moment. But I don't know. There was something just enchanting and magical about that scene that has stuck with me. I know it's not quite what you were asking about, something that really means something to me, but I'm an idealist as an adult. I'm a total idealist. I really want to make the world a better place. I really believe that human beings are just growing in their love and getting better all the time, and that we're getting somewhere together. And so I think that's something that writers like Tolkien gave me as a child, is this faith that we're not lost. All who are wandering are not lost. Ironically, wait a minute.
You said it.
Wait a minute. Pun not intended, but how clever if it was. Yeah. And I think that idealism comes from authors like him.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. I would ask your name, but I guess it's Luigi.
Hi, everybody. I'm Luigi. Just kidding. My name is Benjamin. So first of all, you're awesome. Like Lost, best show I've ever seen. Got me through my freshman year. Well, not really. My grades would show that because I would binge watch so much. Thank you for that. I wasn't too familiar.
It was a lot of hard work, so you're welcome.
I actually saw a guy with like a Dharma Initiative outfit. It was pretty cool. Yeah. So I didn't really know you were much of a writer until now. But I mean, I'll try to make it quick for both of you. So I can see as of now, you know, it seems like you guys put a lot of hard work, creativity, imagination into this. And it's like pretty inspirational. And I want to know, at what point did you guys find like a really hard challenge, and how did you guys overcome it together?
It's a good question. The working process. And
oh yeah,
no,
I mean,
you guys overcome that. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. You just asking that question, I actually was like getting. I was like, don't cry. I've never worked so hard at something. And there were so many moments where I felt like maybe I shouldn't be, like maybe the universe was trying to tell me something because it was so hard to get it to work and to get it out to the world and to have people see it, and continues to be. I mean, it's a challenge to rise above the noise of a saturated media content world. And there were definitely moments where I never wanted to give up, but I felt like maybe I should. And this has been a journey. I mean, I started it, as I said, when I was working on The Hobbit, so that was kind of a long time ago. And there was a point where, when I was looking for the illustrator for the second book, I asked Pixar for artists, I asked Leica for artists, I asked Weta for artists, I asked DreamWorks for artists, I mean, everyone I could go to, all of my connections, and everything was like, no, 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 no. And then I finally would find somebody and we'd sort of have a couple, like I'd get them to do a sample and it was like, doesn't work. And that was 2 years. And in the meantime, the brand was like we were supposed to go from book one to book two to book three and like, you know, build momentum. And the momentum was just dying. You know, we went from book one to nothing for 2 years. And I was getting really concerned that fans weren't going to be engaged anymore. They weren't going to be interested. They weren't going to care anymore what happens to Selma the Spoiled. And that was the hardest point for me. And how we overcame it together was those 8 months of blood, sweat, toil, and tears of me believing in him, knowing that he can get there, that he can do it. I mean, this guy, he studied the class, like he's a classically trained artist. So all it really was getting him to dumb down his art, because he's so good.
Adapting.
And then he believed so much in me, and that, in the most wonderful way, broke my heart. Like the fact that he just kept coming back, you know, and I kind of felt like, why aren't you rejecting me right back? Why are you still willing to try? And just the fact that he loved my poem, and he kept telling me, I love this poem. You don't understand, like I really love these poems, and if I was a kid, I would want this book so bad, and I want to make this book for kids, because I want to give it to my child self, you know? Like I want to do for children what other artists did for me, he would say to me. And that reinvigorated my inspiration and reinvigorated my motivation and gave me the strength to keep going. And, you know, that was recent. Like, we're here today is like we're back on our feet and we're going to get going again and it's going to be great.
Thank you. I wish you all the luck.
Rodrigo, I got to know, what was your reaction when 6 months into it she said this isn't working? Did you lose your confidence?
No, I was just...
I'm practically perfect.
I would have. See ya.
I knew that there was something that was not right, but it easily could be fixed. So I thought that... But I was afraid that she wouldn't have the time to expend more time on this, on believing in me and waiting for all this work. And the one thing that I remember is on the New Year's Eve, I was hearing the fireworks and the 1st of January, and I was painting the first temple that we were working on. So we met in December. I was working exactly in the breaking from the New Year's Eve. So I knew that there was nothing that could take me off. So after 6 months, they said, no, that's not possible. That's not possible. There's something wrong that needs to be fixed. So I started working this. I had a job that take me 8 hours a day. So I came back home, started working at 9 and stopped at 2 a.m., 3 a.m. every day and every weekend. So since December last year to until now, I had some of 3 or 4 weekends off of work, you know.
Yeah, get back to work right now, man. Get back to work.
So this
panel's almost over. Get back to work. Yes, sir. What's your name?
My name is Sam, and this is a question slash, comment slash question for Evangeline. I am a huge Lost fan, so I wanted to thank you personally for that. I was traveling in Europe in 2010 when the finale aired, and I was in Europe, so I couldn't watch it.
You can't get through a panel without a finale question.
So I was traveling, and I couldn't wait. So I downloaded it via iTunes, and I watched it on my iPhone 3G on a train to Rome, and I cried, and I cried, and I cried. And I wanted to thank you personally for that. I wanted to know how the finale affects you today and how it, particularly finale, how it affects your work and just personally. Because I take that with me pretty much.
First of all, you're welcome for that cry. I'm happy to make you cry whenever you want. Yeah. Just punch you in the face. So how many of you hated the finale? Put it in your hand. Be honest, come on. Yeah?
I loved it.
Yeah? Ten hands.
How many people loved it? Okay. How many people have never seen Lost?
Wow.
Oh, shame. We're going to boo you. Shame on you.
Where's the bell? Shame. Shame.
Get out of my panel. So here's my take on the finale. It was just that we spent 6 years asking the world to ask themselves the hard questions. And people would get together and they would stand by water coolers at work on Friday morning, because we aired on Thursday night here, I think. And they would discuss things that they would never otherwise discuss with their coworkers. And they would have thought all night about things that they would never otherwise be thinking about. And parents would sit down in front of the television with their kids, their tweens and their teens, and actually have something to have in common or to connect through. And they would talk about big life questions. And that's what we did for 6 years. And at the end, I feel like a lot of people wanted the opium. They wanted the answer. And the writers refused to give it to them. Instead, they challenged them one more time and left them with the biggest question of all. What was it? What is this? What are we doing here? What are we? The ultimate question. And I think if they had given the answer, then Lost would be essentially like a religion, right? It would be an answer. But Lost is art, and art is supposed to challenge you to find the answers yourself. And so I was very, very proud that we remained true to that, and that we just asked you to search yourself. And for me, if it had ended kind of in almost any other way, I think I would have felt so betrayed that I gave my life to be stuck on a fucking island for 6 years. And then what? For what? You just ruined it. You know, I think I would have felt really betrayed. Instead, I felt like, okay, I did something and it meant something and I'm proud of what I did. Even if it was really, really hard, I'm proud of it. And so that's what it left me with.
Thank you.
Nice. Thank you.
We're pretty much out of time, but I want to get your question real quick because you've been staying there real quickly. Tell us your name and your question.
My name is Robert. And so you mentioned that you might eventually write a sci-fi show. Is there any chance you could act on your own? Or would that just be like way too much?
Well, the truth is, if I want to get it sold, I probably have to act in it. You know, when you're an actress and you come into a studio and say, I've got the greatest idea, you're going to love it. They're like, mm-hmm, are you starring in it? No? Fuck off. So there is a role specifically in it that I've sort of set aside as like, okay, I'd probably play that role, but it's not the lead because it would be too much. It would be just way too much. It would be a, you know, reoccurring role. I can't give any more. I want to talk about it so bad. I can't say anything. That's all I'll say. Thank you for your question.
Thank you, everyone, for your questions. Thank you, everyone, for coming. Thank you to Rodrigo and Evangeline. Check out, you can buy this here, and they're doing signings and photo ops today and tomorrow. Thanks, everyone. Appreciate it. Have a good one. Have a great con.